New York City, the place where you can meet anyone and have a random conversation on the subway, at happy hour, Central Park, or most times, over coffee. What if there was a place that you could go to talk to a stranger, a lifestyle expert, someone that had no strings attached to your life, and a place where you could receive objective advice in tackling your life's dream? What would happen if you only had time for one cup of coffee and helping determine next steps for your life? Claes Williams calls this Brewed Conversations. I'm so excited to meet Carla Espana today. I hear that she has been neglecting her creative passions in the form of singing, and she's been keeping it in the classroom. We'll see if we can change that today.
Hi, I'm Carla Espana. I am from Chile, and I work as a faculty at one of our local colleges in New York City. I'm interested today in having a brewed conversation with Clay because I've been really, really busy for the past few years and in all my work, and it's time that I go back to my first love of music and all things that I love with the creative part of my being, and I've been neglecting that for a long time.
I am so glad that we have a moment to have coffee in Central Park.
It's gorgeous today.
Yeah, it is. Rather be here than be in a coffee shop and to talk about
any day.
Life and why are we here? What's going on?
Okay, a lot's going on. Where do I begin? I started a new job.
Okay, congratulations.
Thank you. Yeah. I'm really excited. I'm about 2 weeks in. I have finally been able to sit down and think about the things that have been on my list, or things that have been, not my list, but like on things that have been sitting in my heart for a really long time that I haven't gotten to.
Okay.
And I finally can sit with that and say, I have the time and I want to put the energy into those creative parts of my life that I neglected.
Okay.
And so that's why I'm here.
All right.
And I need your help.
And what are those creative parts of your life that you feel like you neglected?
I grew up singing, and music has been my first love.
Okay.
So I believe from all the stories, my mom is a great storyteller, all the stories she tells, and my dad as well. I used to sing a lot as a child, and growing up with the a lot of the different church traditions I've been a part of have been huge in providing me the opportunity to explore my voice and be with groups of people and learn more of that. I did some formal study of that in college.
Okay.
And then the older I've been getting and the more adult responsibilities, I've been putting that to the side. And so I miss singing, I miss performing, I miss songwriting,
yeah.
I miss writing my poetry.
When was the last time that you really had like a big performance or a space where you shared your voice?
Wow. Maybe about 2 years ago?
So life happens, we get busy, there's all kinds of things that happens to us, but for you, this was such a big part of your life. You really enjoyed it so much, from the songwriting to performing. What really happened beyond time not being quote-unquote enough?
I think on the surface, what I want to say is, I had a busy job. You talk to any New York City public school teacher, they'll tell you that they spent a lot of hours in the classroom. I think on the surface, I want to say that's been my go-to answer. It's like, I went into teaching, and then, you know, the field of education is really busy, and there's a lot of work to do.
And then
that's
the answer.
That's a safe answer.
Yeah, I was going to say, then the answer that's in your heart is?
I have to admit that I think I'm scared. I'm scared because that's not what comes so easily to me. And it feels like I'm much more vulnerable with exploring that side of me versus the one that I've been used to and had all this formal training in work as a teacher.
All right, so let's go back. So when you say you're scared of something that does not come so easily to you, what exactly does not come easily to you?
I
Because what you've done thus far is you've named it. You said, this does not come easily to me. And now I've asked you what that is, and we don't have a name, an actual thing that we are afraid of exactly.
Okay, I can think of the opposite. That's easier.
Okay, okay.
Can I do that?
Okay. All right.
So what does come easily to me is the work I've been doing as a teacher, whether through workshops with teachers, with children, teaching. I feel really good about those things. So Okay. Maybe it's confidence. So what comes easily to me is things that I feel very confident in because I've had more experience and opportunities to do that, as opposed to the opposite.
Okay.
Yeah.
You've had more experience and opportunities to do that, but that's not true. You've been trained vocally all your life and being able to do it. So let's back up and let's call it really for what it is. It's a belief or unbelief, disbelief actually, in your ability to do what exactly? You do not believe that...
to sing at the level that I want to sing at.
And so when you're doing all these facilitations, presentations, would you not think that's the level of performing?
Well, definitely.
Yeah.
I feel like that's what, when I was in front of sixth graders for a few years in my school in Harlem, that was, felt like I was on stage all day.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And how did you know you were great at that?
I think from the beginning I knew I was not great. children are very honest with you.
Mm-hmm.
And then I had a lot of mentors. I had great people around me who I was able to look at their amazing teaching and get feedback from the kids. So I learned how to hone my craft.
Right.
And I feel like I'm still doing that as an educator. You never stop learning.
Right.
I feel like because I haven't put that time into honing my craft with my singing,
mm-hmm.
it makes me feel more like in a shell because of it, right?
Okay.
Because whether if I signed up for voice lessons, right? For the last few years, I've been with an amazing vocal coach.
Mm-hmm.
And if I see her, let's say twice a month, I get homework, right?
Right.
I'm supposed to practice.
Right.
I'm supposed to be working on my technique. I don't do the homework in between the sessions,
mm-hmm.
right? And I'm at a point like right now, I want to do the homework. I want to dedicate time to it.
So let's take this outside of music. Let's think about feeling good about ourselves. Outside of that, what do you feel great about yourself? Like, give me just a couple of things. When it comes to Carla, what do you feel amazing about?
I feel amazing in my ability to be there for my friends, in the way I help people, in my passion for equitable practices in schools.
All right, so let's
relationships.
Okay. This is too much of other people. You're bouncing it off of yourself. Let's come back to you and let's keep it at a basic understanding of what do you feel amazing about? Just Carla. Nothing that you're doing for anybody else but for you.
I feel amazing? Okay, with regards to because it's easier to talk about what I do, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm more than what I do. Oh, this is so tough, Clay. I know you're taking me there. Okay.
Let's go there.
I love the way I approach life. I have, my philosophy about life is all about, living in the moment and being present, right, with people. I'm all about enjoying life, and this is really difficult.
Yeah. Okay. So while this is giving you something to think about on that end, I bet we can come up with quicker answers on the other end. What do you not celebrate about yourself?
I feel like what I need to improve on, or what I don't celebrate about myself, is that I'm always very busy, and I'm trying to be better at taking those moments that I want to just sit and enjoy.
And you stay busy because you're
trying to avoid possibly I stay busy because I'm trying to avoid confronting my fears when it comes to
things that make you scared or afraid.
Exactly. Okay.
I think you've sung before in front of some amazing crowds, and you sung before when you were really proud of those moments, right?
Yeah.
So close your eyes and go back to those moments. Just go back to one performance. You're in front of a audience, a crowd, whether it's a couple of people. What did that feel like?
Like, I have a gift and I owe it to myself to not bottle it up, to share it. Yeah, like I was being my true self. Like, wasn't putting that away or hiding it.
Yeah.
Like, this is me and I'm open and I am not afraid and here I am. I was very self-aware at that moment.
Ah,
this is
okay.
This is who I am. I love it.
This is who I am. I feel liberated and I feel comfortable. So why have you denied yourself these three very important descriptions? Like, what is it that stands in your way if singing is where that tree is, or singing is on the other side of that tree, and you know the feelings that you have when you are doing that? What is it that is standing in the way of you fully immersing yourself in that? No one's saying that you have to quit your job. I'm not telling you that you have to...
Can't start another one.
Right?
Right now. I just started a new one.
You know, that you have to move here or there, but at the heart of the question, you know, really is, why don't you feel you're good enough? If you know what it feels like, if you understand that you have talent, right? You have a gift.
Yes.
And something you want to connect and share with another person. Why is that not good enough?
I'm wondering if maybe I'm waiting for or seeking the kind of approval or validation. I've received that in other areas of my life.
Yes.
And so instead of just saying like my own validation's enough, I feel like I keep waiting for others. Because I guess in other areas of my life, you either get, as a teacher, you get certification, or you get, you know, awards, student thank you letters, right? In other areas of my life, I've received that kind of external validation of like, you're awesome, you're a cool teacher, thanks. And then with my singing, I feel like it's because I also have done it so much, it's been more of my own personal, and I've been waiting for that.
You hit the nail right on the head. I was waiting for us to have this full circle moment, because when you were, I was asked, how did you know that you were amazing when you're facilitating and teaching? Because someone else told me. Because I received the training. Because people who are higher than me came and said, you are amazing at this. Can we see what the fuss is all about right now? Can you share a song that's on your heart, just in this moment?
For you, Clay, anything.
Can it be in Spanish? You know, it's the language of my heart.
Of course, of course.
Una canción para compartir contigo, Clay.
Gracias a la vida que me ha dado tanto, me dio los consejos que cuando los abro, perfecto distingo lo negro de blanco.
Just be. It's just you and I. We're the only one here. Just let it be. Get out of your mind and let's jump into your heart.
That was
Go ahead.
Oh my gosh. Oh, that song. I was just listening to it yesterday. I want to get through this. Okay.
Yeah.
One more line before.
Okay.
Y en las multitudes el hombre que yo amo. Okay, I don't want to keep crying.
Can you just get through that next line that you wanted to end with? You can go.
I'll repeat that line.
Okay.
En las multitudes el hombre que yo amo.
That was beautiful.
A little Violeta Parra from Chile.
Why the tears?
Because of singing, because I'm singing, I miss it. Two, that song is just really close to where I'm from. I'm from Chile, and I had Chile in my heart yesterday for a lot of reasons, because people were commemorating the 9/11 in Chile that happened in 1973, and then thinking about my family, and so also singing in Spanish, it always brings up so much for me.
So what now, you have this emotional stance, it brings a lot for you.
Yes.
What is the bridge that you need to cross in order to now allow the gift that you have of singing to connect from here to here? What is it that you need to leave behind?
Definitely my fear. My need for approval. I think the same way I think about myself as like being strong and successful in other areas of my life, I feel like I need to internalize that for this part of my life. If this is so important, I need to give it the time.
Right. And so the way for you to get over this fear is that connection that you just shared with us right now, like how the emotion that it brought up, the tears.
Yeah.
Is to learn how to let that flow in song. If it comes over you, it comes over you, because what you want to do is get over that at first, right? Because I think the excitement that you have inside is, I'm actually doing it.
Yeah.
The more you sing, the more you hone that craft, the stronger your emotions are going to be, and the more in control of your gift you're going to be. Because right now it's all over the place emotionally, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that power lies in you. I hope this has been a really enriching time for you, and just thank you for sharing your story. I'm sure it's going to be a blessing to so many people who are experiencing some of the same things.
Thank you, Clay. This is very affirming, but it's also so like what I need. I need to be reminded of this,
yeah.
And I also need that kind of push.
So yeah.
You're giving me a healthy push.
And push comes home.
Yes.
All right. What I want you to do, beyond your vocal coach, I want, since there are four seasons throughout the year, one performance per season.
Okay.
And it has to be at least one other person in the room besides you. Okay?
Okay.
I'm talking about where you're inviting people to come, and you will have a arrangement of songs that you'll like to sing. And literally, as the seasons change, I want you to note and write down what has changed for you as an artist, as a performer, but most importantly, what has changed for you as a person. Because once that self-confidence kicks in, you are going to rise to be the artist that you have been called to be.
One per season?
Per season.
All right. Starting next spring.
Fall. Now.
Fall.
Fall. This is in a couple of weeks. Right now.